Good morning. It is a privilege to be with you this morning, and I would like to take a moment to say thank you to Majors Mike and Carolyn for giving me the privilege to be with you on this CCM Community Care Ministries Sunday. And so for our theme today, we're going to have a look at James chapter 5, and I will begin reading at verse 13 to the end of the chapter. Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being, even as we are. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. My brothers and sisters, if one of you should wander from the truth and should remember to bring that person back, remember this. Whoever turns a sinner from the error of their way will save them from death and cover over a multitude of sins. This is the word of the Lord. CCM, Community Care Ministries. It's a multifaceted ministry. Cards, phone calls, emails and texts, hospital and home visits, a coffee at the cafe, or dropping off a casserole to a struggling family. It is a ministry of walking with people, listening to their stories, and seeking to understand their journey. CCM ministry has its function through the formal ministry group known by that name. Yet, it is more than that, as many of us try to live on purpose every day, to be open to God's leading, to touch people's lives in the moments of our daily coming and going, and to respond personally to those promptings of the Spirit. CCM ministry has its moments where solutions don't come so easily as drop-offs, calls, and cards. We struggle to make a difference with the bad health report, a tragic death, or the desperation people face in so many other ways. It was Martin Luther who said, "Pray like it all depends on God. Work like it all depends on you." We seem to have the work part down. We slug away at solving problems and working through to solutions. But how often do we approach the challenges from a stance of prayer? That before I act on any idea I have, my first response is prayer. One of the most beautiful elements of our privileges with people is praying with them. May I pray with you? For some, offering this gift is very hard. It doesn't come naturally or easily. So to you, my encouragement is to keep at it. Don't give up in finding the courage to invite prayer into a given situation. For others, it comes much more easily. Prayer in my family of origin came naturally and without inhibition. I have many memories of Bible reading and prayer at the Sunday dinner table, and prayer when working through challenges. I remember a visit with Mom and Dad in February 2016. At the time, Dad's health was rapidly declining. One evening, my mom was helping my frail dad get ready for bed when I heard their voices from the bedroom. It was rather loud as they engaged back and forth. I wondered what was going on and so went to the room to check on the situation. The scene is riveted in my mind. Dad was sitting on the bed and Mom was kneeling beside him. He was praying and Mom was supporting with amens and speak, Lord, and other similar phrases. He prayed for me. He prayed for my siblings. He prayed for other things and people and concerns. In his frail, weakened state, his prayers were for others. In May of 2016, he went to be with the Lord, promoted to glory. Prayer is not a fearful thing. in our immediate family. I am so grateful that we were raised on the staple of prayer. In our text, we find the story of a people oppressed and facing injustice. They weren't being paid wages for their work because their employers hoarded wealth for their own luxury and self-indulgence. It is these abused that James says in verse 13, "Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray." He continues with the value of prayer and the fathers of faith whose experience was saturated with prayer. So what's James's story? According to Clement of Alexandria, James suffered plenty. He was called on by the scribes and Pharisees to settle the people down in their radical acceptance of Jesus as the gate to the kingdom. They had him stand on the pinnacle of the temple for this task. James's response was similar to Stephen's declaration of seeing the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of God. Seeing they failed in their quest, the scribes and Pharisees threw him from the pinnacle of the temple. We don't know how high that was. The information suggests the highest point of the temple would have been 450 feet or 137 meters by the time it reached the Kidron Valley. We can conclude that the push from the pinnacle was not a standard house rooftop. The fall from being pushed or thrown off the pinnacle did not kill James, so the leaders began to stone him. And James began to pray, and he prayed the very words of the Lord, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." One of the priests instructed them to stop, because James the Just was praying for them. To that, another grabbed a fuller's club, a club used for beating clothing, and struck a blow to James's head and killed him with it. They buried James on the spot of his death. Isn't it true that those most affected by hardship are those who most understand the hardships of others? And so James, in his own journey, teaches us some valuable lessons about patience and prayer. And he teaches us, first of all, that patience accompanies prayer. In verses 7 to 12 that precede the verses I read a few moments ago, James speaks of being patient and waiting for the Lord's return. And then he uses the analogy of a farmer who waits for the crop. And so he launches into his response to injustice by telling the people to be patient. So a word to the suffering. Many times, the first discipline is patience. But patience is hard. I wonder if it's become harder in our instant society of microwaves, DoorDash, GoFresh food orders, and at your fingertips electronic access. We want it, and we wanted it 30 seconds ago. In fact, without patience, it may be very hard for us to be given to the discipline of prayer that follows the instruction about patience. It is not an author's blunder for James to instruct about patience before he gets to prayer. I don't know of a situation where an impatient person first understands a disciplined prayer life. When we get to prayer, the discipline is intensified. Prayer is waiting work, waiting for God to do something, waiting for change in my situation, waiting for the physio to work, or waiting for a call for the interview. We're all in a season of waiting, sometimes not so patiently, for the masks to come off and life to return to normal. Sometimes we can make a situation harder when trying to care about other people. In our well-intentioned hearts, we spill words like, "There are better days to come," or "This too will pass," which is not usually helpful counsel for people who are in the middle of crisis and pain. Sometimes the best we can do for them, aside from hearing their stories and walking with them, is asking them, "May I pray with you?" Sometimes people need the prayers of others in seasons when it is hard for them to be patient and to pray themselves. James also teaches us that prayer is an act of faith. And we read that in verses 13 to 16 of this text. It is a language of faith and faith community relationships. There is mention of actively praying, singing, calling the elders of the church for prayer and anointing, and confessing sins to one another. In one of our congregational appointments, one of our leaders would say he lived for Sunday. He was completely swept up in the euphoria of being with people of faith and being energized and uplifted by those times together. Confessing sins is not a suggestion of unfiltered exposure with anyone who will listen. It is, however, an invitation to be real people in a community that loves you and wishes nothing but the best for you. These will do all they can to help you succeed and overcome the sins that get in the way of that success. What stands out to me most of all in these verses is the integral part that a family and faith community has toward helping one another in spiritual vitality. The functions of praying, singing, and confessing transform the people even when the situation remains. The grief can still linger. Sometimes the prognosis is not altered or the pain doesn't go away. But we pray because we know God will hear the longings of our hearts and bring what needs to be brought to the situation. And he wants us to share our hearts and the deep longing of our souls. And there is another lesson that James brings home to us. He teaches us that prayer releases latent power or dormant power. In verses 17 and 18, he speaks of anyone wandering from the truth and bringing that person back and turning people from the error of their ways. James offered a good reminder about the power of faith when praying. He speaks of Elijah being human. Verse 17 seems to suggest that the people thought him to be more than the rest of them. He wasn't, James seems to be saying. He says Elijah was a human being, just as we are. The miracle of no rain and then rain was not the result of a man who was more than a man. It is the story of a man who had faith, who prayed in accordance with what God wanted, and so he knew praying for a drought and then for rain, these would occur at the appropriate times. We shouldn't pray with a defeatist mindset and wonder if anything will come of it. This is the danger that James speaks of in verses 19 and 20, of wandering from the truth, wandering from an active prayer life, wandering from trusting God and taking matters into our own hands, which often lead to making a mess of it and even compromising our faith. Desperate times can lead to desperate measures, measures that we wouldn't have imagined something I'd ever do. We can fall into sinful responses to life's crisis because patience, waiting on God, and prayer, engaging with God, were left out of the equation of our living. And so in these days of considering the valuable work of community care ministry, we are encouraged to be reminded today that for the pains and troubles of our lives, let's resolve to look to the Lord with patience and a disciplined prayer life. It will help us to see clearly and follow the Lord more closely. But not only that, these will help equip us to minister in his name as we seek to bless others and encourage them daily to Jesus. May God richly bless you in these days.